Hello everybody, welcome to a special session where we are going to summarize a very important chapter in 10th chemistry, and this is known as acids, bases and salts. A lot of students generally tend to find this chapter very tough, and I think it just makes more sense for us to start summarizing the entire chapter so that even if you have to look at it 5 minutes before an exam, or even if you're driving to your exam center, or if you just want to revise it a day before your exam, you have everything ready in one shot. And we'll try to summarize this in as little time as possible. Now let us try and understand what all went into this chapter in the first place. So let us try and understand and start summarizing the term acids. The first thing we all need to know is acids are those chemical substances which release H plus ions in aqueous solution. So the word aqueous solution is very important. Without water, no chemical can show any acidic characteristic. Now this H plus ion gently tends to combine with that water to give you hydronium ion. So the key words you need to remember when it comes to acids is H plus ion, which is your hydrogen ion, and hydronium ion. What do we know about acids? Acids can be organic acids, which are directly obtained from plants or animals, or they can be inorganic, which are basically just called as mineral acids. Now you might forget certain important organic acids. You can just remember citric acid because it comes from citrus fruits like lemon and orange. So I'm sure all of you will be able to remember citric acid. Lactic acid comes from milk, so you will also be able to remember that. Mineral acids are your normal acids that we use in most of the chemical reactions. HCl, which is hydrochloric acid, then your nitric acid, then your sulfuric acid, and so on. Alright, then let us try and understand some of its properties as well. We know that acids are sour to taste, and the best way to remember the taste of acid is just to taste lemon. You know lemon tastes sour, so acids are sour to taste, as simple as that. Let us try and understand what happens when you treat it with certain types of indicators. Now, generally in phenolphthalein indicators, acids remain colorless. Or when you add a couple of drops of phenolphthalein indicators to any container containing an acid, there will be absolutely no change in color. It will remain colorless. However, if you have to understand what happens to a litmus paper, always remember a blue litmus paper turns red in an acidic medium. And the best way to remember this is by the word bar, B-A-R, which indicates that acid turns blue litmus red. Just remember it like that. So when you're doing it for base, you know it's the reverse. Alright, then let us look at all the chemical properties of acids or the chemical reactions we know. The first thing that we need to understand is when acids combine with bases, they give us salt plus water. When acids combine with metallic oxides, now metallic oxides are also basic in nature. When acids combine with metallic oxides, they also produce salt plus water. And we know these two reactions are called as neutralization reactions. We also know acids, and here we generally refer to dilute acids. Concentrated acids are not required at all. When acids react with carbonates or bicarbonates, it could be sodium carbonate, it could be potassium bicarbonate, any of these, it will give you three products. One is salt, the other is water, and the third one is carbon dioxide. And we all know how we test for carbon dioxide in the lab. It's a colorless, odorless, tasteless gas, which is slightly acidic. Therefore, when you pass it through lime water, it initially turns milky. And when you pass excess carbon dioxide through the same lime water, the milkiness will disappear. That is how you test for carbon dioxide in the lab. And the last one is, whenever we look at any active metal, now all of you hopefully will remember what active metals are. All metals that are placed above hydrogen in the reactivity series are active metals. So you might all remember what this will give you. Yes, the first thing that it is going to give you is salt. And the second product it is going to give you is hydrogen gas. And all of us know the test for hydrogen gas as well. Whenever you bring a burning matchstick to the mouth of the test tube where hydrogen gas is getting liberated, the fire of the matchstick is extinguished with a pop sound, right? So these are just basic summaries of acids. But if you want to add extra information to it, you can always say the pH range for acids is 0 to 7. This is the pH range. Now, generally when it is 7, it is neutral. Less than 7 and closer to 0 will make it more acidic. Anything closer to 7 will make it less acidic. So this is your entire summary of acids, and I'm sure most of you might remember this. Let's also move into the next part of the chapter, which are bases. Now, when we talk about bases, let's summarize bases just like the way we summarized acids. Now, we said for acids, you need H plus or H3O plus in solutions. For bases, you need OH minus ions in solutions. Apart from that, there are certain bases that are water soluble. These water soluble bases are called alkalis. And if anybody asks you to remember a few alkalis, please remember these three: sodium hydroxide, potassium hydroxide, and ammonium hydroxide. These would be the best examples for alkalis. Now, apart from that, let's also look at some of its features. Now, while we understood acids are sour to taste, bases are bitter to taste. Now, how will we remember this? When you're washing your face with soap, and if some amount of soap gets into your mouth, you know what the taste is. It's bitter. Therefore, bases are bitter to taste. That is because soaps also contain bases. Apart from that, let us look at all the other properties that we need to know about bases. One, let us look at what happens to phenolphthalein. Phenolphthalein in a basic medium, phenolphthalein in a basic medium turns pink. In acidic medium, it is colorless. In a basic medium, it turns pink. Now, we learned about bar, where we said acid turns blue litmus red. So, bases will turn red litmus to blue. Alright, let's also look at the pH range. The pH range for bases is from 7 to 14. If it is closer to 14, it is a stronger base. If it is closer to 7, it is a mild base. Let's also look at some of the other properties that we need to know. There are a lot of bases that are corrosive. In fact, many acids are also corrosive. Corrosive bases are called caustic bases. The best examples would be KOH, which is sometimes also called as caustic potash. Sodium hydroxide is also called as caustic soda. Caustic means something that is corrosive. The other thing that we also need to now understand are all the properties. Now, there are certain metals. What metals are these? Aluminium, lead, tin, and zinc. These metals tend to have very similar reactions with acids as well as bases. Since they have similar reactions with both acids and bases, these metals are called as amphoteric metals. Please remember these examples. I'll give you a small example to show you how amphoteric metals work. Now, if you take zinc and if you treat it with hydrochloric acid, we are going to get zinc chloride plus hydrogen gas. This is how your reaction is going to be. If I take the same zinc metal and if I treat it with sodium hydroxide solution, then I'm still going to get a salt plus acid. But the only difference is I'm not going to get a simple salt like this. I'm going to get a salt like this. This is called sodium zincate, Na2ZnO2 plus hydrogen. So if you notice, all the four metals, I've just taken an example of one, but all the four metals tend to give you similar products. It gives you one salt, it gives you hydrogen. Therefore, these four metals are called as amphoteric metals. After that, we also have another simple reaction. There are certain non-metallic oxides that are acidic. For example, if I take sulfur dioxide, sulfur trioxide, phosphorus pentoxide, nitrogen dioxide, all these are acidic gases, carbon dioxide, all these are acidic gases. Since they are acidic, when they combine with bases, they need to give us salt plus water. Studying like this will help you understand and remember a lot of things in the chapter in a very short span of time. Right? So with this, we are also done with bases. See, it's taking us such little time to summarize each part of the chapter, and I would like you also to write it down just like this, or at least look at it 5 minutes before your exam so that everything is refreshed in your memory. Now, let us go into a major part of the chapter, which are salts. Now, what we are going to learn under salts, which is something you've already done, are special types of salts. Now, what are the special types of salts we have learned? We have learned about sodium chloride. And whenever we think of sodium chloride, think of slow evaporation of seawater, because you're trying to manufacture it on a very large scale, right? And you cannot use basic neutralization to manufacture salts because the yield is low, and you will not be able to use it on a very large scale to maybe get into the food industry because you have so many people to feed, right? Now, what are the major uses of sodium chloride? One, it is used in the food industry. It is used as a dehydrating agent because it removes water. And the best way to remember that it removes water is every time you swim in the sea and accidentally drink seawater, then you feel very thirsty at the end of it. Why does that happen? Because salt is a dehydrating agent. It removes water from the body. Right? It is also used in the leather tanning industry to cure leather. Then let's look at the other salts that we have. The other salt that we have is washing soda, which is Na2CO3.10H2O. Na2CO3.10H2O is prepared by a process called Solvay's process. And what goes into Solvay's process? Multiple things go into Solvay's process. You have ammonia, you have water, you have carbon dioxide, right? And then apart from this, you also have sodium chloride. Okay, when you mix all of this together, you are going to get two products in the first step. You are going to get ammonium chloride plus NaHCO3. Then after this, what you do is, by the process of filtration, remember this is highly water soluble, this is sparingly soluble, so you will be able to filter it out very quickly. Once you filter it out, just heat this. When you heat it, you will get Na2CO3 plus H2O plus carbon dioxide. You almost there, you need Na2CO3.10H2O, you already have Na2CO3. To this, if you just add 10H2O, you get a crystalline salt which is Na2CO3.10H2O, which is called as washing soda. Now, what are the uses of washing soda? Washing soda can be used for cleansing purposes. Apart from that, washing soda can also be used to remove hardness in water. These are the two major examples you can remember. Apart from that, another major salt you can also remember is sodium bicarbonate. Now, sodium bicarbonate is also prepared by Solvay's process. It's just that you stop at this stage itself because sodium bicarbonate is already formed for you. Sodium bicarbonate is also called baking soda. Here you might expect multiple questions on the uses it may have. Some of the uses of baking soda is it can be used in a fire extinguisher. Now, what fire extinguisher is this? This is a soda acid fire extinguisher. So, you use baking soda plus you use sulfuric acid. And you get a soda acid fire extinguisher. The other thing is it can also be used in baking cakes or in the baking industry, where along with baking soda you also add a little bit of tartaric acid to remove the bitterness caused by baking soda when you add it to the cake. This neutralizes the bitter taste that you add to the cake. Finally, another major use of all of this is you can make tasty crispy food. And in case you get an upset stomach because of that, you can also use this as an antacid. That's about it. Now let's move into the next salt. The next salt we have is bleaching powder. Bleaching powder has the formula CaOCl2. Bleaching powder is generally manufactured by passing dry chlorine gas over quicklime. Quicklime is calcium oxide to give you CaOCl2. If you want to use calcium hydroxide, you'll get calcium oxychloride plus water. Now, there are special names you might remember for all of these. This is called sodium carbonate decahydrate. This is called sodium hydrogen carbonate. This is also called calcium oxychloride. Now, the last major salt that we have to remember is, which I'm going to write here, is plaster of Paris. Plaster of Paris is obtained from gypsum. Gypsum is CaSO4.2H2O. Please make sure that you heat it to a temperature less than 100 degrees centigrade. When you do that, you will get CaSO4.12H2O plus 3/2H2O. Now, plaster of Paris, which is what you see here, has multiple uses. What are some of the uses of plaster of Paris? One, it can be used to make toys. Now, some of the toys or even some of the Ganesh idols that you get all across the world is generally made of plaster of Paris. You can also use that to mend fractured bones. So, if some of you have ever had a fracture or if you know someone who's had, generally what the doctors do is set the bone right and then they apply plaster of Paris and then they start adding water to it. This is also an important point to keep. When you add water to plaster of Paris, it hardens to give you that cast. That is why whenever you're dealing with plaster of Paris, always keep it in moisture-proof containers because you wouldn't want it to come in contact with water. The moment it comes in contact with water, it starts hardening out and it will reform gypsum for you. Alright, and the other major use of it is to make fireproofing materials. We'll also quickly talk about the uses of bleaching powder. Bleaching powder is used to bleach clothes, as simple as that. More important thing is it is also used as an oxidizing agent. Now please remember, oxidizing agent is due to the presence of nascent oxygen in bleaching powder. Bleaching action is due to the presence of nascent chlorine. Alright, so with this we have summarized all the salts as well. The last thing that we have is to summarize the manufacture of sodium hydroxide by chloralkali process. Now whenever you manufacture sodium hydroxide by chloralkali process, there are few things you need to remember. One, you need to use sodium chloride plus water and you need to pass direct current through it, so it's a process called electrolysis. You get three products. The first product is sodium hydroxide, which will be formed in the container itself. Chlorine gas being negatively charged will be formed at the anode, and hydrogen gas being positive will be formed at the cathode. This has multiple uses. Chlorine, we all know, is a disinfectant. When you look at hydrogen can be used as rocket fuel. Sodium hydroxide has multiple uses, which I spoke about in the beginning. It can be used in the manufacture of soaps. So with this, we have actually completed summarizing the entire chapter in the easiest way possible. So I hope you enjoyed the video, and I hope you are in a position to understand the chapter much more. Alright, thank you very much, and I wish you all the best for your exams.